Good evening and welcome to another edition of Truth Connections Radio. We are very happy you're here this evening, and we are also happy if you're listening to our Blog Talk archives or our YouTube channel. I'm going to bring my co-host on right now. Rand Porter, are you there?
Yes, Catherine, how you doing?
I'm doing great. Happy to see you this evening. We have a great show. We have a gentleman by the name of Santos Bonacci, 30 years of study, and is an expert in the field of astrotheology, philosophy, religion, and astrology. Born with an innate ability to connect dots and symbolism with ancient mysteries and the law and its deception. Got a lot of information that we're going to discuss today. The truth is always connected to lies because they can literally bank on the fact that most of us will miss the forest from the trees, and it is hidden in plain sight. It's up to us if we are open to receiving the knowledge. So join me in welcoming Santos to the show. Santos, are you there?
I am. Thank you.
You're very welcome. We are pleased to have you here. Fascinating information that I studied from you all week. I honestly don't know where to begin. Should we talk about what's going on inside of all of us at the current moment, what we need to do for ourselves and our own enlightenment?
Yeah, that'd be a great place to start because it's certainly the most important aspect because there's out there and there's in there. And when you look out there, when you look out there in the world on the secular plane in what's known as the mesocosm, you see the microcosm is the small world within. The secular plane out there, that bread and circuses that you see going on, that's the mesocosm. And the macrocosm is in the stars. Now, to go within, you see the kingdom of God is within. And that means that everything that comes under God's dominion, and we're going to define what God is in a minute, by the way, everything that comes, see, it's the kingdom, the dome of God is within.
Yes.
That dome is your skull. When you look at your head, and we're gonna talk about all these beautiful body parts that in the Bible are known as the Holy Land, Jerusalem, Dan, Bethel, Bethlehem. I'm going to introduce you to the body parts that they correspond to in the microcosm. Yeah, the pineal gland, the sacral chakra, the optic thalamus, etc. So, and I've touched a lot on the microcosm in my videos, but I've probably dwelt more on the macrocosm and the mesocosm. And I reckon I've neglected the microcosm. So I'm going to do a presentation shortly where I will be uncovering the gospel within. God, let's get back to God. Jesus said the kingdom of God is within. Everything is in your body. Everything, the whole universe, in a microcosm. You are it. God is light. The Bible tells you that. John, the letter of 1 John, and I think it's verse 5 of chapter 1. God is light. Now, light is undivided. Undivided light is what God is. When that divides, it produces electricity. Positive and negative, which we call electricity and magnetism. And the whole universe is produced by this. Protagoras said, man is the measure of the universe. Leonardo da Vinci said, the workings of the human body are an analogy for the workings of the heavens. Now, I've explained what this means in my videos. And I'll just briefly lay the foundation for the microcosm story that is in the gospel. The sun travels, it rises in the east and sets in the west, and it travels along the ecliptic. The ecliptic is the path of the sun that it faithfully travels. Its trajectory in the sky, year in and year out, there he goes forth on the ecliptic. Following the sun are the six orbs of light that we see called the moon, Mars, Venus, Mercury, Saturn and Jupiter. And you can watch them. You can watch them on the ecliptic. Right now, when you go outside at night, you will see Mars right next to the star Regulus in the constellation of Leo. Once Mars stops retrograding and goes direct, you will see it just virtually go almost on top of Regulus. Look out for it. It's going to be great. That's the ecliptic. Regulus is the only star of major importance, one of the four most important stars in the sky, that is actually sitting on the ecliptic, right on the ecliptic. Now, that ecliptic runs through your body. It starts in the top of your head, right at the pole of the dome of your head. And that spot is always left open in the domes. When you go to some of the domes in Rome, for instance, the Pantheon. The Pantheon is a famous building which predates, you know, most other structures there in Rome. And it has that little opening at the top of the dome. This is the North Pole. This is the dome that is your head.
Very interesting.
And it relates to the cerebrum. Okay? The equivalent word in the Bible is cherubim. Have you heard of the covering angels called the cherubim?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that would be your cerebrum. Now, in the ecliptic, that corresponds with Aries, the Lamb of God. And the tribe of Israel is Gad. So the top of the head belongs, the whole body, the whole ecliptic, there are 12 signs of the zodiac, starting from Aries in the head and finishing with the two fish, Pisces, at the feet. And I'll go through the order of those in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
But the tribe of Gad, which is otherwise known as God, is in the head. And below Aries, Gad, is the tribe of Asher, called Taurus. These are the two lost tribes, because the head, the most important dome of heaven with all the important glands and organs, the heavenly organs of the body, are separated from the torso, the other 10 tribes of Israel. Now, I hope I don't lose your listeners, and I hope I don't lose you, because I know this is very deep, but this is how the whole system works. It wasn't invented. It wasn't concocted by the Sumerians or the Egyptians or the Mayans, as they like to say in consensus buffoon world. It's there. This science is there. Leonardo da Vinci, Marsilio Ficino, all those Renaissance masters, they saw it. They didn't invent it. They acknowledged it. You just acknowledge it. Now, Gad, God, is in the head. It's the cerebrum. Taurus is also in the head. It corresponds to the cerebellum. The cerebellum is the heart brain. You see, you have your frontal lobe and you have all your lobes. Your cerebellum's this lobe at the back and at the bottom of the brain. And that is the man, that corresponds to Adam man. Whereas Aries, Gad, the cerebrum, this corresponds to God-man. Now, it's so important to understand this. This is occult science. In other words, it's hidden science. They're not going to tell you about it at Harvard. They're not going to tell you about this at Stanford. Forget about going to Oxford or wherever you want to go for your education. You won't get it. You won't get it there. You have to search around for this sort of knowledge. It's hermetic, it's Neoplatonic, it's in the Bible, as you will see. The story that I'm about to unfold will blow your mind. Beneath the cerebrum is the claustrum, and it's called the Holy Claustrum, or otherwise known as the Santa Claus from Santa Claus. And you see, Santa Claus, he has this nice fluid, and this fluid is otherwise known as Christos, the oil, the holy oil of the lamp. And the cerebrum produces this fluid, which flows down the spinal cord, and it goes right down to the bottom where you will find the tribe of Scorpio. That's your sign, Kathy, isn't it?
Yes, it is my sign.
You're a Scorpio. Okay,
yes,
so... I'm Aries, I'm Arian, I'm in the head, and the fluid goes from Aries in the head, from the claustrum, the holy claustrum, and it's a secretion. And take note that the word secret is hiding in the word secretion. In other words, secretion comes from secret.
That's interesting.
Okay.
Yeah. These are the sacred mystic secrets, you see, that they don't want you to know about. The Apostle Paul said, "Oh, Galatians, oh, Corinthians, how I would love to have taught you about the inner esoteric teachings of the Christ, but you are still babes in the Christ, stuck on the primary doctrines of baptism and all of this. you're little children spiritually. You're still at the psychic level. You haven't even burst through to the spiritual or the mystical." So this secretion, it flows down the spine and it goes all the way down to Scorpio. And it traverses Gemini. So after Aries and Taurus in the head, you've got Gemini, the two arms, the two hands. And when you look at Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper, you will notice that the third sign from the left, starting from Aries, you'll see his disciples, the 12 disciples, are grouped in threes for the four seasons, spring, summer, autumn and winter. And you will notice that the third guy is holding his hands up and showing his palms directly in front of his face. So he's telling you, after Aries, my friend on the right over here, and Taurus, comes the twins, the hands, Gemini. You see, because Leonardo da Vinci knew that the human body is the microcosm of the sun's ecliptic, the zodiac belt. So Gemini is the hands, and then Cancer is the chest, and Leo is the heart, and Virgo is the belly, Bethlehem, the house of bread, and we're going to get back to that one. Next is kidneys, Libra, and then the generative area is Scorpio. Well, the secretion, yeah, and you're starting to work it out now. The secretion comes from heaven. It comes from Gad, from God, from Santa Claus, the claustrum, flows all the way down the spine. And you know, what goes down in a distillery is the in a distillery, you've got the sludge at the bottom and you've got all the aviation fuels that go right up to the top. The higher vibrating essences. They go to the top. The spinal cord is likened to a distillery. When that secretion goes all the way down to Scorpio, down to the testes in the man and the ovaries in the woman, Scorpio, they then have an opportunity to transmute their sexual electric energy and get that sludge. In the case of a man, that would be the sperm. They would be able to save it rather than waste it. And they would be able to transmute it into finer essences, because as you save the seed, you see, the Christ, because that's what the Christ is. It's that seed, that oil that comes from the claustrum. Christos in Greek means oil, simply oil. And when you transmute it and you save that beautiful sexual energy, you see, the tragic thing with humanity is they've lost the way. The moment they get sexually aroused, they're looking for a way to dispense with that beautiful energy rather than sending it back up to Gad, back up to the pineal gland. You see, when that oil bursts the chakras and goes through every stage of the spinal cord, it increases its vibration, it increases its electric force, and the kundalini rises and rises as mercury rises, because you see, this fluid is the mercury in the thermometer. The hotter it gets, the warmer it gets, the higher the mercury rises. And you see, if you send that up the spine, eventually, when the spine returns to Golgotha, or Calvary, where the Christ is crucified, that oil, the Christ, crosses the pneumogastric nerve, right near the optic thalamus, and that crossing is the crucifixion. Its energy is increased 1,000-fold, and you have been crucified. The optic thalamus has received the oil. The optic thalamus looks like an olive. It is the olive that sits on top of the rod of Aaron, the spinal cord. And finally, it gets baptized with the Christ oil, And one is anointed with olive oil, as the scriptures tell us, the holy scriptures. And the Greeks call the optic thalamus the light of the world. I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness. And so once one has, you see, that the pineal gland sits directly in front of the optic thalamus, and the pituitary gland sits directly behind it. The pineal gland secretes the honey, and the pituitary gland secretes the milk. They're all secretions, secrets. But this is the land flowing with milk and honey. If you can get there, good luck to you. But I'm telling you that is the journey. That is the story of all stories. It's the story of Humpty Dumpty, Little Red Riding Hood, Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. For Snow White is the sun, the white, unrefracted light. And the seven dwarves would be the seven refracted colors that are in the rainbow.
Isn't that something?
But however you want to put it, it's always the same story. It's Jesus Christ and his 12 little helpers, or his seven little helpers, the refractors of light called Jupiter, Saturn, Mars, etc. And you see, the reason why they go after astrology, oh, they tell you in church, oh, God, the Bible condemns astrology. But you see, the Bible also condemns money, lawyers, usury, priestcraft, tax collection, empire.
Isn't that the pot calling the kettle black?
Yeah. They also condemn a certain class of people called scribes. You know, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, who shut up the kingdom of heaven to these little sheep, and you throw away the keys of knowledge, and you yourself hinder these little sheep because you are not going in, so neither do you allow them to go in. You see, these priestcraft or these scribes, they'd be your notaries. And how many little churchgoers are quite happy to use the services of lawyers and the money, the cash that they have in their pockets? And how many go to the bank to enroll and borrow some of that money, which is debt-laden, so that they can participate in usury? Because, you see, all of churches are part of the scam. And all of the services that they use, which the Bible also condemns, along with astrology. But see, the thing with astrology is that it's beneficial because you can cure yourself with natural herbs and crystals, and you can know who you are with the science of astrology. Whereas the lawyers that they go to, that are also condemned, they're part of the system which they support, Babylon the Great. So there you have it in a nutshell, and look, I just laid that down for you so that I can build on it, because I've just scratched the surface. I've barely scratched the surface of this story. And it's so powerful. And when you lift up the Christ and you raise your soul and you get that oil going up that spine and you reach the pineal gland, you'll know who you are. You'll know what's what. And you will know. You won't believe and have faith. Oh, believe in Jesus, the third party vicarious savior. He'll come one day in the clouds and, he's just going to save you. Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and Catholics and all you other Protestants that despise each other and the unbelievers, so-called. You can hear the passion in my voice. I know that. I'm not embarrassed.
I recognize that passion.
Yeah, I'm not shy, because look around at the apathy and the inertia.
Absolutely.
And the fluoridated pineal glands and the people that go off to the football and keep up with the Joneses, and they're part of the problem. They're part of the problem.
That's the most frustrating part of the problem, in my opinion, just trying to get people to listen, but you can't really force people to listen. They're going to see if they're meant to see, don't you think?
Absolutely. Yep. When the student is ready, the master will appear, and the master is within.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go to any of these. I would not be running off to any gurus that are running around. Sure, I mean, there's some great teachers out there, but, you know, I'd be inclined to go to the more scientific ones, like the ones that the likes of Emmanuel Velikovsky and Walter Russell and Wallace Thornhill at thunderbolts.info. I'd be inclined to go to guys like Nassim Harriman, Dan Winter, Stan Tenen, Greg Braden, Bruce Lipton. We don't need gurus. The guru is within. It's the pineal gland. Yeah, if you want to know some stuff, well, activate yourself. Get yourself going. Go within. The answers are there. We are all of the same gad, the same god. Aries, the claustrum, and the secretions are all going on in all of our bodies, unless we've shut them down. And by the way, living life riotously, as the Bible says, you know, the prodigal son, these stories in the Bible, they're magic. If you want to know what's going on within, read the Bible. It's the best.
Mm-hmm.
The prodigal son says to daddy, oh, daddy, your kingdom's great up here, but I'm going to go down and I'm going to go and eat some of that stuff down there. There's prostitutes down there and there's wine. See you later. So off he goes, the prodigal son, and he wastes his life in riotous living. Well, that's the claustrum. The claustrum sends down all these beautiful secretions made from ether, made from light.
The etherical.
Oh, yeah. And it pours it down. And the first thing we do is we run off the moment we get sexual desire and we discharge that electricity. We earth it. We waste it like Onan, the son of Jacob, who married his daughter, who was Judah was one of the sons of Jacob. Judah had three sons. The first son married a woman and he died. Whoops. Second son's got to marry that one. So the second son marries her. He dies. Whoops. Third son, Onan, marries her. But Onan wastes his seed. So he was not getting her pregnant, which he was supposed to for the Jewish tradition of birthright and inherit, you see. Now, Onan, if you go to Japan, someone who masturbates there is called an Onanista.
Interesting.
Yeah. So now this is not anything against sex. Sex is electricity. It's who we are.
Absolutely, but we have to be wary of who we choose to interblend our auras and our energies with, because it could hurt us instead of helping us, you know?
Absolutely. It can be detrimental. That one of the most beautiful things that we have, just like anything, water saves us, but we can drown in water. Just like anything, there's the good and the evil. There's no such thing as good and evil. In the right brain, there's no such thing. In the left brain, where everybody is working out of, yeah, there's good and evil. So there's polarity. But really, good is evil and evil is good. Light is darkness and darkness is light. They are just varying degrees of the same thing. But you see,
it's the polarization that people have issues with, is what you're saying. The balancing of it all.
Yeah, well, they believe too much in the polarization of it. They believe in it. They think it into reality. Whereas in the right brain, there's only unity. There's only one of everything. And this is what my work shows, the syncretism, the syncretic nature of everything. So I deal comprehensively with all the subjects, all of them, science, physics, theology, philosophy, and show the syncretic nature of everything. Everything is interrelated, as von Humboldt.
Absolutely everything. It's not a mistake.
It's
a common thread, yeah.
Yeah, and you see, this is what they don't want you to know about astrology. Every month when the moon is in the sun sign that you were born in my case, Aries, coming up in a few days, because the moon is in Aquarius right now. Next is Pisces, and then Aries. That's the moment that a germ is germinated in the solar plexus, which is above the sacral plexus, where Scorpio dwells. So in your case, Kathy, that'll be in Scorpio. So you need to follow the moon. Please, I urge you, follow the moon. Because if you save that seed, and by the way, this happens in males and females. This is a spiritual, psycho-spiritual womb that both genders have. The physical womb only the feminine gender has. But we both have the solar plexus. The solar plexus is the ganglion, a nerve ganglion, which has 12 nerve endings. They are the 12 tribes of Israel, and they are connected to the 12 dorsal vertebrae. And the seed is born within the solar plexus monthly.
Yes, there's a reason why that's where we give birth from, too, you know?
Yeah.
All the energy.
Yeah. In my case, in the next 4 days, when the moon goes through Aries, that seed will germinate. and I need to abstain from sex. Absolutely abstain from sex. Because if I discharge that sexual energy, that seed's gone bye-bye. And you have wasted that secretion for that month. And you have 12 opportunities every year, 12 tribes of Israel, 12 disciples of the Christ oil, to get that oil transmuted. And this is where science, the knowledge of physiology, the microcosm, is so important. Alchemy, occult science, it's urgent, it's imperative. And I urge the listeners, before the end of the year, this year, before the 21st of December 2012, if you're going to read one book, go to Amazon and purchase the book titled God-Man. Very important that you understand this God-Man, then semicolon, the Word made flesh. That's the title of the book. I'll repeat it if you've got a pen and paper. God-Man, and then semicolon, the Word made flesh, by George W. Carey. It was printed in the early 1900s. You can get copies of it because it's a gem. And it discusses the gospel within and how we can raise the Christ, because we are Christs. We are crystal. We are crystals. Carbon crystals. Organic carbon animated crystals. We are the jewel and the wonder of the universe. We are light bodies, and mankind is an exquisite stage in the evolution of the universe. As Brahma, the creator, breathes out, exhales and inhales the breaths of Brahma, the universe is doing this. It's all happening in pulses. As Walter Russell says, the universe is like a pump, a two-way pump, electricity and magnetism, breathing out and breathing in. And the God, the universe, the light, God is light, does this from the neutrino to the galaxy clusters. Everything is in spirals, in torus fields, and everything emanates from the photon. It's a dipole, and it's a torus. And that little torus, see, light doesn't travel. No, no, it does not travel. You know, they say in consensus science, oh, light travels in 186,000. Light does not travel, it stays put. The photon reproduces itself. Those torus fields are reproducing themselves.
Interesting.
And they do this in fractals, in Fibonacci spirals, throughout the universe. And by the way, Fibonacci, Bonacci is my surname. Fibonacci was Leonardo Bonacci's nickname. Fi means the son of. He was the son of a famous mathematician in the 12th century. He introduced the Arabic numerals to the West and to the world, and hence dispensed with the Latin numerals, the Roman numerals, which were so difficult with mathematical computations. And he simplified maths forever by introducing the numbers that we have, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 that we recognize now. And he also introduced the golden ratio and the Fibonacci sequence of numbers, which I've explained also in my videos. And it's that fractal, that 1.618, the phi, the golden section, which is how the light spirals forth and unfurls and creates all of the motion, which scientists like to call the elements of gold and hydrogen and sulfur and whatever, sodium, oxygen and nitrogen, etc., which are just different rates of motion. So, look, I better have a breath, eh, and let you...
Absolutely. I know Rand wanted to ask a question about...
Yeah.
It might be relevant to what you were just discussing a few minutes ago.
Yeah, Santos, are you aware of the Atlas prophylax adjustment? It's like a type of chiropractic type adjustment where they adjust the uppermost vertebrae, and it's what your skull actually sits on. And they say that everyone is born with it out, and they've proven that, and that we were actually created that way so that we wouldn't have a complete kundalini microcosmic orbit. And there's a whole movement now to have it set back in so that it re-energizes us and gives us more access to our inherent energy inside of us. Have you heard anything about
that? Yeah. I used to do the Alexander technique. Alexander was a Tasmanian man who discovered he was singing in opera in the 30s, the 20s and the 30s down in Tasmania. He went to New York, I believe, or London, and anyway, he established the Alexander School in the 50s. And many of your Hollywood artists and opera singers to this day practice Alexander technique so that they can liberate this and free the skull and have the skull sitting properly on the head in order to be able to function properly. And I used to do this for years, the Alexander technique. It saved me. Along with many other yogic practices. And look, it's by these practices that we save, in parentheses, save ourselves, or in quotation marks, I mean, because the word save, salvation, salvation comes from salt and gives us the words salary, saliva, salty saliva, and salvation means to preserve the body and the soul and the spirit, our three natures. So how do we do this? Well, simple. We raise the Christ. We raise the oil. If we're going to live in the bottom chakras, all full of fear and just concerned about money and power and wealth and having sex like animals and eating and drinking, well then the oil stays down there and it's sludge and we vibrate according to that frequency. Well, if you're happy with that, good luck to you. And I wish you all the best, whoever you may be. Churchgoers are certainly in that category because all of the practices in church, all of them, whether you go to the Jehovah's Witnesses and they tell you, oh, Armageddon's coming, brothers, you know, the bearded God Jehovah is sitting on his throne and you shouldn't be dancing or drinking coffee or whatever. All of these fearful words and fearful notions and all the belief structure that they base their exoteric church on, they are all very destructive to this light process, this enlightening process. Think of the word enlighten. You see, they replace that with educate. Oh, let's educate the people. We've got to educate the children. Well, why don't we enlighten them? You see, light is Christ. When you're christened, you're enlightened. Or you're supposed to be, at least. You know, and that's the oil.
I wish it was that easy, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's, you see, that's bringing the oil back up to the claustrum, Santa Claus, because Santa Claus travels down the chimney and he brings those good little prezzies. But we're supposed to raise that back and give it back and do our tithing. Give back to God 10%. We've forgotten to tithe. That's what it means. Tithing means to germinate that seed and save the seed, 10% of it, and work on it and transmute it and understand the power of sex and what it is for. It's a tool for transmutation. We have to turn the lead into gold. The lead is down the bottom and the gold's upstairs, the stairway to heaven. You know, it's funny, one of my favorite songs, I grew up listening to Led Zeppelin and Stairway to Heaven, and I was told, when I became a Jehovah's Witness, I put Led Zeppelin away because Stairway to Heaven was all about the devil, you know, and getting back to the devil and all of that. But that gold that they were talking about, you know, if you listen, you can hear it in the wind. It's blowing in the wind, and if you buy that gold, it's talking about it in the scriptures. It's actually Jacob's ladder. The stairway to heaven is the same ladder that Jacob saw in Genesis chapter 35. Now get this, Jacob lays his head on a stone, and Queen Elizabeth claims to have been coronated in 1952 on the stone of Scone. That stone, that's the stone that Jacob laid his head on, according to their Jesus bloodline counterfeit story that they're trying to push out there to mankind, that there's a historical Jesus bloodline. I'll get back to that because there is and there isn't. But Jacob, the stone of Scone is the sacral, the five sacral bones in the vertebrae. There's 33 bones in the dorsal vertebrae, right, the spinal column, and they are separated. There's five different sections. The second bottom most section is the sacral, I forget the exact name now. Anyway, they're five fused bones. That's Jacob's stone. That's the stone. You see, Jacob had a dream. He laid his head down on that stone at the bottom of the ladder, and all of a sudden he sees angels going up and down this ladder. That's the spinal cord. And then he sees God face. He struggles with an angel, of course, because it is a struggle to get that oil flowing up the spine. And then he sees God face to face, and he lives. He gets a name change from Jacob to Israel, and he says, I have seen God face to face. I shall call the name of this place Pineal. Pineal?
Not a mistake.
Mm-hmm. So I think we've found Jacob. And by the way, Jacob means, if you go to your little etymological church dictionary of Bible words, you'll find that Jacob means heel catcher. Heel catcher means if you wrap the human body around a circle, starting at the head and ending at the feet, and the feet, the bottom of the feet, the heels, touch the back of the head, right? So the back will be arched, so that the heels come back around.
Like a yoga position or something.
Exactly. And if you put that in a circle, the zodiac circle, and you start with Aries at the head and Pisces at the feet, that is exactly how the occultists depict the heel catcher, Jacob. Hmm. Because Jacob is none other than Israel, which is the Maseroth, which has 12 tribes, Aries, Taurus, Gemini, etc. And it's Adam Kadmon, the zodiac wheel. So Jacob is the heel catcher. And look, it's shameful. It's absolutely shameful what they're teaching in the churches, the counterfeit version of this, in order to enslave those people, get donations. Sorry, did I say donations? That's
bribe money, more like it's bribe money.
I had another word too, tax, yeah, tax yes. collecting. Because you see, my friends, have a look at the M-O-N words, you know, monopoly, money, monarchy, monotheism, all of the dirty, filthy words that the elites have used in order to enslave mankind, because they monopolize it all with their money, which is a fictional construct. It's absolutely unnatural. With their monotheism, which is a counterfeit version of this truth that I'm sharing with you, and with their monarchies, you see, we've been led to believe for thousands of years that they have divine right. They've got blue blood. And isn't it funny that we know that we have red blood? I wonder what Genesis is talking about when it says, when the Elohim, the so-called Elohim, say, let us make man in our image. And then in Genesis chapter 3, it says, God was pleased with Adam and Eve, and he called them Adama. He called them Adama. We are the Adama, the race of the Adama. Adama means red blood.
Huh.
You see, the blue bloods, they've been tampering with the natural children of light that have been organically evolving on this planet and manipulating the genes, etc. And this is why they sit on thrones in their monarchies around Europe and all over the place, and trafficking in opium and selling it to Chinese in their East India companies, and morphing into the Federal Reserve and the IRS, and doing business with the Vatican and the Rothschilds and the Phoenicians of Venice and the black nobility. You see, when you start talking like this, your consensus people, you've lost them. They've got no idea what's going on in this world. But they will, and it's coming.
Well, that's just it. We had I watched a documentary a while ago, and I'm not going to quote who said it, because I don't recall exactly how they said it, but they said that the Vatican knows all about the spiritual rules of engagement, and they hide things in plain sight, and it's our problem if we don't see the signs. That in fact gives them a pass spiritually, because they have put the information out there, and if we don't find it, shame on us.
Yeah, disclosure. They've got their legal out. They have to follow the universal law of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, thinking, speaking, doing. And that's how everything gets done. Aries, Taurus, Gemini. Aries is, remember, the thinking place, the cranium, the cerebrum, where the secretions come from. Speaking is Taurus. Taurus rules the mouth, the logos. The logos is the word. So you have to first think it, then speak it from your Taurus cerebellum, and then Gemini, the air, the Holy Spirit, air, is the active force, the doing. So how do they do this? Well, they go to their little think tanks, i.e. the Club of Rome and the Bilderbergers, and they think up some wild stuff like, well, why don't we put radium and aluminium and feces and blood plasma and microfibers in stuff, call it, you know, whatever, and spray it in the air and give humanity a gift of chemtrails. And then they tell you that they're going to do it in their scientific journals. Oh, we're going to put aluminium in the atmosphere to protect us from all of this evil solar glare that's causing global warming, which Al Gore is going to invent a tax for called carbon tax, and Julia Gillard, Australia's bankster crime prime minister, is going to give us some carbon tax. I promise you, you will not have carbon tax if I get elected. Next thing you know, we've got carbon tax for Al Gore. Congratulations, Al Gore. Struck the deal. And you see, the Bilderbergers and the Club of Rome, they tell you that they invented this lie of global warming back in 1982.
I'm sure they're proud of it.
They're proud of it because look at all the people going around, think green, green movement, do the green thing, do the green thing. All these consensus idiots repeating erroneous opinions by these think tanks that think things and then they tell you, hence the legal out and the disclosure, and then they go and do it. Look around. Water's got fluoride in it. Lovely. Because the elites, I mean, they don't care about much when it comes
it's
to...
It's all so truly connected. It just drives me crazy how connected it is. Why doesn't everyone else see it?
Yeah, the water, the food, the air, they pretty much got all the bases
covered. Surprised they don't charge us for air these days. I honestly am.
Yeah.
They're getting to that.
That's coming.
They'll figure that out.
I'm sorry, Santos. I didn't mean to interrupt your...
No. I was just going to say, you know, I mean, they care for your teeth. So they put fluoride in your water because, I mean, they care for your teeth. And they're so sincere. And people believe that. Never mind the oil spills that they don't care about and the raping of the earth and the trashing of this planet for their plastic products and their aspartame-filled, sugar-free E. coli feces that people are chewing on. You see these guys, these sportsmen, you know, they're great sportsmen with great physiques, and they're chewing. And they're chewing sugar-free gum, of course, because they're conscientious, aren't they? And they're
aspartame.
Looking after, yeah, aspartame. And guess what? It's poisoning them. They'll be dead. They'll be dead before they know it.
Absolutely.
And Donald Rumsfeld is kicking back, cleaning up with royalties. His bank account in Switzerland must be beaming. It must be, he'd have a good bank account, put it that way.
Not to mention the fact that they get a free pass on trading on insider information, so how can they not be rich? It's just insane. Santos, we have a caller holding. I didn't notice it. I've been holding quite a long time. Do you mind if we take a caller?
Sure.
Okay. You are live with Truth Connections Radio. Who's calling?
Are you talking to me?
Yes, I am. You are live on the radio right now. Do you have a question for
Santos? Wow. Not really, but I think early in mid-March when he was on another show, since then I've been looking at the videos and everything, and it's great to see or even to have knowledge of everything and getting it connected. And I even recommended him to a lot of people as far as in getting more informed about what's going on.
Thanks for that.
Yeah, and believe me, it has helped me a lot because I've been doing my own research, and all I needed was just somebody to really connect it to who have a little bit more knowledge and a more foundation in order for me to do it. But I definitely appreciate everything, even this conversation that you was having right now. I'm actually taking notes as well. So,
It's all about building on the knowledge. Don't let all the information stress you out, because it is a lot of information. You just keep building on it, and you see more of the picture every time. So keep up the good work.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you for calling in.
Yeah, thank you.
You have a great night. Now, Santos, this might be off track a little bit. We have to go to break in a minute. Maybe we should just go to break now and come back a little more fresh. How's that?
Great.
Thank you. I would like to encourage everyone to check out our truthconnections.wordpress.com website. There are links there to all of our past guests and their websites. And we also have a new library that houses links to everyone's books who have been on our show, because, you know, we'd like to have the information available to you, not just today, but after the fact. And if anyone likes to submit some music to that website, we are open, because we like to shine a light on artists and keep the creativity flowing. Now we're going to play a song by a band called Villains Like You, and it's called Light Me a Candle, appropriately so. Enjoy. See you in a few. Thank you for hanging out with us this evening. We really appreciate it. Santos, are you there?
I am.
Great. I wouldn't mind if you would go into some of the hidden hieroglyphic meanings. I had a question. If the scarab is Cancer, is a representation of the zodiac Cancer, what are the hieroglyphics trying to tell us about that?
Oh, lots. Lots of stuff. Cancer is at the tropic. Okay, so in the northern hemisphere, when the sun hits the tropic of Cancer, you're enjoying this beautiful summer period. And the moon rules Cancer. That's the only sign she rules. It's a cardinal water sign, and it has three hieroglyphs. Hiero means holy, and glyph means writing. So the Bible is just a bunch of hieroglyphs, holy writings. The Quran, hieroglyphs. The three symbols for Cancer are the unicorn. Now, you might wonder where that one comes from. Well, right next door to Cancer is a constellation called Monoceros. Monoceros means one horn. It's a horse, and it's standing right behind Orion. So the unicorn's there. It's not far from Cancer. The scarab was the ancient glyph, and now we have the crab, the Cancer crab. Either way, the crab is, we get the word crabby. Someone who's crabby is not happy. And the crab is not happy because he's got to walk sideways. He's got a sideways walk about him, you see. And they placed this sign there for the very reason that when the sun hits the Tropic of Cancer, it gets crabby now, even though it's in its glory, it's summer and everything like that. But from that point, when it hits the Tropic of Cancer on the 21st of June and enters the sign of Cancer, the crab, the crabby one, that's the longest day of the year. From that point on, the days decrease by a few seconds every day until it hits the Tropic of Capricorn and it's midwinter, the shortest day of the year on the 21st of December. So that's why the crab's not happy. And the sun appears to now be going sliding, backsliding, or going sideways rather than climbing up the mountain, you see, because from the Tropic of Capricorn to the Tropic of Cancer, see, Capricorn's the goat climbs. So there's the sun, he begins on the 25th of December, Christmas Day, when the sun is born, in the sign of the goat. So there you go, Jesus is a Capricorn. And that's why we like to call our children kids, you see, because Capricorn is the sign where the greatest kid of all time, Jesus, mm-hmm. is born in the sign of Capricorn on the 25th of December. So, of course, we're going to want our children to be kids, like Jesus, baby Jesus, the son in Capricorn.
It's a very powerful day, isn't it?
That's right, it is. Of course it's powerful, because why? Well, if you're watching the sun on the horizon, you'll notice that it stops on the solstice for 3 days. Doesn't move. Then all of a sudden on the 25th, bang, it's flying off again to the other tropic. And it goes from tropic to tropic, solstice to solstice. And you can watch it. I solar gaze and I watch the sunset on my deck. I've got a beautiful big wooden timber deck. And my brother-in-law comes out and my sister, I teach everybody to solar gaze and we're all standing on the veranda watching the sun. Staring right at it, and people drive past and they must think we're crazy. Half of us are on the roof on the roof of the garage, and we're just lined up, me and my brother and brother-in-law, and we're watching the sun. My sister says to me, because this is her first year in doing it, and she's going, wow. She started watching at the solstice in December 4 months ago, and it's gone through the equinox in Aries on the 21st of March already. It has traveled 20 to 30 degrees on the horizon. Man, that orb is a travel and fast. You can notice it. My goodness, you can notice every day that the sun is moving on the horizon. Mm-hmm. And it's only 1 degree in 8 days. But 1 degree on the horizon is a long stretch. And so every day he's in a different position. But on the solstices, he stops for 3 days. And when he begins, like you said, on the 25th of December, it is a very powerful day. That's the little goat climbing up. And you see, let's go back to that kid thing I was saying, because one or two of the listeners might think I've stretched that one a little bit about the kid. On midnight, the 24th of December, Christmas Eve, that's the moment that the child is born, and that's the moment the sun begins its journey up to the Tropic of Cancer. So what happens on midnight on the 24th of December? Well, if that's the moment when Jesus is born year in and year out for the last 2,000 years. Now, we know that the 25th of December is not in the Bible. It's not anywhere in the Bible. But this is the trick, and I'll get back to this, because Christians, I get a lot of churchgoers that write to me and saying, Santos, everything you've done is wrong, because Jesus was not born on the 25th of December, and it's not, no one knows when he was born.
And I have to write. Quit thinking with those lower chakra vibrations.
Yeah, and I've got to write back, and oh God. Anyway, but if that's the moment, we're talking about science here. at midnight on the 25th of December, 24th of December every year, the sun begins its journey to the allotropic. And on the ascendant, if the sun is in Capricorn at the time, which it is, it's the 25th of December, that's Capricorn. So if the sun is in Capricorn, at midnight, the rising sign is Virgo. That's the Virgin. See, that's the sun being born of a virgin. So you can rest assured then, if we're doing this historically, that Jesus is a Capricorn with a Virgo rising. And take a look at all the pictures that you see of Jesus. You see this effeminate man with long golden hair and blue eyes, and he's kind of like a girl, and he looks like Virgo. I wonder why he looks like Virgo. Well, if you understand what they're doing esoterically, like Leonardo da Vinci when he painted the Mona Lisa, which is just Jesus, by the way, Hermes. Every other painting is showing you the same thing. It's showing you that they know the birth chart of the person, anyone being born at that given moment. They will be a Capricorn with a Virgo rising. So they will have those features. Now, if you know astrology, and you look at all the paintings that have ever, you know, the good ones that have ever been done of Jesus that make him appear to be effeminate, you'll understand what they're trying to tell you. That is a Capricorn. He looks like a goat. He's got the Capricorn features with a Virgo rising. Now, in order to understand this, you need to understand how all the 12 signs of the zodiac do actually affect the features. And the most important aspects of astrology that affect your look are your sun sign and the rising sign. You see? They are 50% each, or 100% of how you look. In my case, I'm Aries with a Leo rising. So when people who don't know me see me for the first time, they see me as this, you know, this guy walking around with a lot of confidence and a very feline attitude, you know, the lion, you know, like I'm the king of the jungle, sort of tiger or something like that.
The Leo is who you emanate to the world, and
exactly.
The Aries is who you are on the inside.
Exactly. But the Leo has given me some physical features. And you can see it. I've pointed them out to people many times. You can see my Aryan Leo features. They stand out. And man, I can look at people walking down the street and I can go, oh, that's a Pisces. that's a Capricorn. You can just see it. You can have fun with this. And then I just walk up to people many times because I have to, because I can see their sign. I've got to ask them just to confirm it. Just to confirm it, you know. I don't have to, because I can already see it. I can see Saturn, where Saturn is in the body. I can see where Mars is in the body. I mean, I can tell you I've got Mars in Leo on the ascendant. So, I mean, talk about passion and action. Mars is the action planet in Leo, the heart. So I've got this fire in the heart. Of course I'm going to be talking like this. I've got action in the heart. So you can describe yourself to people astrologically, you know. And isn't it so sad when you see people who consider themselves to be intelligent that mock astrology, you know? Oh, what are you talking about, Santos? Stick to your music.
If the planets and the moon can affect the tides, how is that not a powerful entity all by itself, you know? How is the sun not just as powerful, if not more powerful?
Well, yeah, I like to tell people that have got more than a fleeting interest in the subject of truth, and they've got 5 minutes to sit and listen, I like to tell them about the star system Sirius A and Sirius B. Sirius is the brightest star in the sky, and Sirius B orbits that star every 50 years. And back in 1989, scientists were watching Sirius B because it was for the first time they've realized that Sirius B was going past Sirius A. In other words, it was going in between our sun and Sirius. Okay? So it was going to come in between, pretty much like a lunar eclipse or like a new moon. The new moon is when the moon is between the sun and the earth, all right? And this was what was happening. It was a new moon for the Sirius star system setup. And what they noticed with their atomic clocks is that as Sirius B passed between the two orbs, our Earth slowed down in its orbit, in its rotation. And then when it went past, after a couple of weeks, then it sped back up again. So if a star, one of those twinkle, twinkle little stars, how I wonder what you are having a slowing down, one star that we're aware of at least, slowed down the Earth's rotation by a couple of seconds in 1989, and this was measured, and it's a scientific fact which we cannot run away from, I think we might want to start contemplating that subject of astrology, the mother of all science.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and get away from the lawyers and the scribes and the tax collectors and the churches and priests and all the other stuff that the Bible condemns, and get back to reality.
Santos, that leads me to my next question I had for you. Do you have any thoughts on the Asterian astrology, the theory that Western astrology is off by 23 degrees, and that we, as Westerners, failed to calculate the precession of the equinox, and the Egyptians, the Buddhists, the Hindus were all aware of this and called it the science of light? Do you know anything about Asterian astrology, that there's 27 different astrologies than what we actually have? I don't want to confuse people even more, but I think it's important to talk about it.
Yeah, there are. And look, there are parallel systems, you might like to call them. But what I'm showing, the Hermetic astrology, the Egyptian stuff, what I'm showing is that they based it on the interaction between the angles of the bodies out there, the planetary bodies. That's what they based it on. And Thomas H. Burgoyne explains it the best when he says, as the sun appears to go around every year 360 degrees and it takes 365 days, it progresses 1 degree every day. Therefore, the angle of photons, the angle of light coming to the Earth that the sun is interacting with, it's all about angles. Angles are angels. And there are good angels and bad angels, good angles and bad angles in astrology. And I'll explain those in a minute. But as the sun goes around and all the other orbs, and they're always changing position and changing their angles, that's what astrology is based on. So it matters not that the stars have slipped, because we're not worried about the stars. Yes, the equinox is happening in Pisces. We've been in the age of Pisces for 2,000 years, and the equinox has been happening in Pisces and not in Aries, as astrology has it. But it doesn't. The slippage, the 30 degrees or 32 degrees of precessional slippage that has happened since 2,000 odd years ago, when all of the stars and astrology happened to be perfectly aligned. You see, modern-day scholars like to ridicule astrology. Again, this is another attack against astrology that works.
That's why I thought that maybe that's the way the planets were aligned tens of thousands of years ago, so that's why they did it that way.
Yeah, well, we were lucky 2,000 years. Every 24,000 years, Aries lines up with the vernal equinox. And this is great, but it doesn't mean that it's based on... The stars are going to be slipping all the time. So ignore the precessional slippage and get back to the angles. It's all about angles. Because on the 21st of March, every year, forever, the sun will enter Aries. It will never enter Pisces. So people who try to tell you, oh, Santos, you're not an Arian. You're actually a Piscean because 24th of March is now in Pisces. It's precessional slippage. No, thank you very much. I'll stick to true science. I'm Arian.
My friend tried to tell me I was a Sagittarius. I was like, but I don't like that. I don't want to be that.
No, you're Scorpio, and that's that. It will never change. It will never change because it relates, as Thomas H. Burgoyne explains, it relates to those angles. And the bad angles are squares, 90 degrees or 180 degrees, simple as that. And the good angles are 120 degrees and 60 degrees, and that makes triangles. A grand trine, for instance, if you have a grand trine in your astrology, that's three lots of 120 degrees. They are called, Thomas Burgoyne calls these the angles of joy, or the angels of joy, and many people have them. Tom Cruise has a grand trine in his birth chart. He was born under a grand trine, and he has three planets that are in their original houses. I think Mercury is in, what is he? He's Cancerian. So he's got the moon in, hang on, I've got it here. Let me share this with folks.
Go right ahead.
it's worthy of note. And then people can go and check Tom Cruise's birth chart, and they will see. I'll find it anyway. If you've got another thought you want to follow.
I would like to talk about numerology and how all that ties into what can give us the answers to what we need to do.
Okay.
Like astrology.
Yeah. Tom Cruise has a grand water trine. Jupiter in Pisces. Jupiter rules Pisces. That's one planet, according to Firmicus Maternus, the 4th century astrologer. He says if you have one planet in its natural home, now Jupiter rules Sagittarius and Pisces, right? So Tom Cruise has Jupiter in Pisces. I also have that. He has Saturn in Aquarius. I also have that. And the third thing he has, which I don't have, three signs in their planet, or three planets in their sign, he has Mercury in Gemini, and Mercury rules Gemini. So he's very lucky, and he's got a grand water trine, Neptune in Scorpio, the Sun in Cancer, he is Cancerian, and Jupiter in Pisces, and there you have this beautiful grand trine. The guy was blessed. This is what you call smooth sailing. He's got a lot of angles of joy. He's a happy man. Numerology. Let's have a look at some numbers, shall we? We've got even numbers, which come from the word Eve, the woman. The numbers 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, these have an evil connotation to them. 2 was the number Pythagoras spat on the ground whenever it was uttered, because it was division. 4... 4 has to do, in Japan, 4 is shi, and shi also means death, and they avoid the word shi and 4 like a plague, like we avoid the number 13. In Japan, my wife comes from North Honshu, the main island of Japan, right up. She was born in a town called Hachinohe. Hachi means 8. And there's a series of towns from 1 through to, I think it's 9, so Hachinohe is 8 nohe, which means village of 8. So they've got Ichinohe, Ninohe, Sannohe, and guess what? There's no 4. It goes straight to Gonohe, and then it, yeah. And I asked my wife, what's with the 4? And she says, oh, yeah. Well, I already knew. I mean, I've been to Japan 5 times. I know that 4 has this evil death thing about it. 6, 6, 6, 6. The hex. Carbon, 6 protons, 6 electrons, 6 neutrons. Solidity. So you see 2, 4, and 6. Whereas the 1, ooh, that's male. 1 is unity. 3 is the Trinity. 5 is the pentagram. You know, Leonardo da Vinci's Vitruvian man, he has 5 points. You see, the head and the 4 limbs, they make up 5. So man is an etheric creation of the number 5. So you see all, and then there's 7. The number 7 is like, oh, the Jews say that when God created 7, 7 is the most beautiful thing in the universe for God. And then the next male number is 9, you know, the 9th heaven, the number of divinity.
Can I tell you something? I have 23 letters in my name, so I did my numerology, and I came out with a 9 soul urge, and I actually have 2 9s and 4 7s in my numerology reading. Is that good?
Oh, yeah. 9 is that magic number that is everywhere when you look for it. In the Bible, it's everywhere. 144,000, add up the digits, they come to 9.
Huh.
666, add up the digits, they come to 9. 6 plus 6 plus 6 equals 18. 1 and 8 is 9. Another number, the 153 fish that St. Peter caught when Jesus, the resurrected Jesus in the Gospel, the last chapter of the Gospel of John, the resurrected Jesus appears on the beach and he's cooking a little fish and he yells out on the boat, he says, have you caught anything? And they say, no. And he says, cast your net to the right side, which means to the right hemisphere of your brain, because unless you work in the right brain, the hermetic brain, you will catch no fish. And they brought the fish onto the beach and they counted the fish. What for? Did the fish really need to get into the Gospel of John? Are they that glory and fame hungry that these little fish that they... Oh, please count us, for God's sakes, get us in there. Well, it could have been any other number, but they happen to have a number that adds up to 9, 153. And in Pythagorean and Archimedean mathematics, that is the number of, guess what, the fish. The number of the fish is 153. Now, at this stage, if you don't mind, I would love to read one very short chapter from the book that I mentioned in the first hour, God, Man, the Word Made Flesh.
Absolutely.
Just so that the listeners can be in ecstasy when they hear the exquisite richness of this beautiful, beautiful work.
Absolutely. Take it away, Santos.
Here we go. This is a short chapter called The Journey of Joseph and Mary, subtitled The Marvelous Story of the Journey of Joseph and Mary to Jerusalem to Pay Their Taxes, Physiologically Explained. Notice the the intonation in my voice.
Mm-hmm.
Physiologically explained, very lazily, because the guy's like, this guy is actually blown away by the fact that churches are still pushing, peddling the historical Jesus story that was invented by the Caesars of Rome. He's like, I mean, all the guys I read are like, they're bewildered at the fact that the churches have survived for so long, deceiving the masses. And here's what he says. Let me see if I can get through this without going on a tangent, which I like to do. On either side of the thalamus in the head is a gland known in physiology as the pineal. On the posterior and the pituitary on the anterior side of the thalamus. The pineal is cone-shaped and secretes a yellow or golden fluid. Remember I said pineal gland secretes the honey and the pituitary gland secretes the milk. It's the land flowing with milk and honey. So it's very important to get the Christ going up there. Send Santa Claus back up the chimney real quick. So the pituitary body opposite it is ellipsoid in shape and contains a whitish secretion like milk. The fluids that are found in both these bodies come from the same source, namely the claustrum, which means barrier or cloister, and is referred to as cloister for a very good reason, that a precious and holy thing is secreted or secluded there. Santa Claus, or Santa Claus, is another term for this precious fluid, which is indeed a holy gift in the body of each one of us. The precious fluid which flows down from the claustrum separates, part going to the pineal gland and part to the pituitary body, and these, being special laboratories of the head, differentiate the fluid from the claustrum, and it takes on the colours above mentioned, and in the pineal gland becomes yellow and has electric properties. The pituitary body, having the milk-like fluid, has magnetic properties. These two glands are the male and female, the Joseph and Mary, of the physical body. They are the parents of the spiritual son, born in the solar plexus of each human being, commencing about the age of 12. This yellow and white material, which is the milk and the honey referred to in the Bible, the children of Israel having been given the promise of return to the land flowing with milk and honey, at last reaches the solar plexus, the semi-lunar ganglia, the Bethlehem of the physical body. In Hebrew, Bethlehem means house. Beth is house, and Lehem means bread. I am the bread of life, said the allegorical Jesus. In the solar plexus is a thimble-shaped depression, a cave or manger, and in this is deposited the psychophysical seed or holy child born of this immaculate conception. This psychophysical seed is also called fish, as it has the odour of fish, and is formed in the midst of the waters, the pure water. Jesus is a fish in the midst of the waters, said Saint Augustine. Before birth, the human fetus floats like a fish in the fluids by which it is surrounded. And as it is with the child formed on the generative plane, so it is with the spiritual child born in the solar plexus and Bethlehem. Joseph and Mary, by furnishing the material for the spiritual child, which was to redeem the child or body formed in generation, paid the symbolical redemption money. The Holy Ghost, Greek for breath, the breath descending the pneumogastric nerve into the solar center, centers the manger where Joseph and Mary are, and where Jesus the seed, literally conceived by the Holy Ghost. And there you have it. That's just one short chapter.
Wow.
And that shows you what's in this book. If there's a book that you need to read before the end of 2012, it is this book. And this is the true story, the true physiological story of salvation by which we can regenerate our bodies. Because when you do this, you can live for hundreds of years. Death is occurring because we are wasting that particular seed of the month. And we don't know about it. We don't know better. I didn't know better. I've lived my entire life not knowing better. I now know. And this is why I am so active in getting on radio and doing presentations and sharing a lot of my life, which is very taxing on my health and very demanding. But it's so important that we get humanity back on track. Everything is within. The kingdom of God is within. The Apostle Paul said, the Christ dwelleth within. It's all in there, and everybody's looking out there. And they are being distracted and entangled by the material desires of incarnation.
Someone we had on prior to your show said that they were told by someone that you could actually taste in the back of your throat when your pineal gland was activated. Are you familiar with anybody saying that to you?
I'm not familiar with that, but you'll know it. You'll know it. It will either come nice and slowly, bit by bit, or it will come in one hit. But let me tell you something. In the Bible, it talks about eating of the manna and of the bread and the wine. You see, that fluid that is secreted from the pineal gland, that's the new wine. Jesus gives you new wine. But, you know, the Apostle Paul spoke about people who were eating of the sacraments unworthily. And what this means is that some people are actually bursting their pineal gland and eating, partaking of it, unprepared. They haven't done the spiritual yards. The evolution is not there. So they rush forward. Do never rush in this. It's all about science. The Egyptians knew the science. That's why they built the ascension chambers, the pyramids, to help people and to qualify people that were initiated. They did not take everybody that knocked on the door, because in this life, many people are just not ready. And those people who eat of this bread and wine unworthily, they have a psychosis. They actually don't. They stay in that crystallized form and they never return.
Wow, that's interesting.
Oh, yeah, you... This is all about science. This is the holy science.
When Reiki masters or mystics start speaking in tongues, does that mean that their pineal gland is activating, or does that mean that is that activity coming from their pineal gland?
Yeah, well, the 120, and take note of the name, number 120 disciples at Pentecost that had fires above their head and were talking in tongues, the first of their kind in the Christian, so-called Christian context. This was referring to not a literal occurrence. It's referring to the fire, the halo that emanates from people that have ascended. And ascension simply means this. You've ascended the oil from the solar plexus up to the pineal gland. That's what it means. For all of these new ages and people that are, you know, beating the drum for ascension being something like the rapture, or, you know, we're going to meet Jesus in the air and whatever. It's all happening within. You go to heaven inside. Heaven's in the head. It's in Gad. It's in the cerebrum, not the cerebellum, where most people are living, the throne of God, but in the cerebrum, in Aries. Aries, the Lamb of God. And you go to heaven there, inside. So these halos, they light up. And the American Indians, they used to wear their feathered plumes. You see, the chief of the tribe had his beautiful feathered plumes. You see, that's the pineal gland. It's activated. And you speak in tongues. Don't be confused with what the Pentecostals are doing down at the local church, speaking in tongues. What they're doing is what you would call, commonly called, demonism. What they're doing is they are allowing astral shells to inhabit their psychic field. You see, they remove their etheric body and another body takes their own body, and they are controlled mediumistically by another entity, usually an evil low-life entity that cannot ascend, or in other words, that the atoms that are left over from the magnetic bodies which we are when we die, these continue on in the spirit realm, in the invisible realm, as astral shells. Now, they are perishing the moment the physical body dies. Just like, you know, the moment you're born, you're dying. A child born on the first day of his that's when you commence dying. And the same thing happens with this magnetic astral shell that leaves the body when you die. It looks to prolong its life. And to do so, it attaches itself to nervously weak-minded individuals who are mediumistic. And Manlick P. Hall says that these people are more dangerous than anything else.
Yes, I think the channeled information must be very suspect to everyone, and you should discern, because it's not a joke allowing something to enter your body and speak through you. It's very dangerous.
Yeah, automatic writing and all of this stuff. This is someone else doing
mm-hmm.
it. Now, Manlick P. Hall says, if you don't know, then why are you asking someone else to inhabit your body that claims to know? Mediums are born. Clairvoyants are made. There's one clairvoyant to 1,000 mediums out there. And these people are dangerous to themselves, dangerous to the astral shells, dangerous to the universe, and dangerous to humanity, because they lead people astray and they are charlatans. When you hear people speaking in different voices, like, I have a message.
I'm sorry.
What the freaking hell? What the? What? What is that shit? Yeah, and they got followers. I mean, come on, let's grow up.
They got people paying for a ticket. They got more than followers.
Oh yeah. They're touring the planet. You know, they're $200 a ticket to go and see some of these goons, and they're channeling Zerubbabel. Oh, today we're channeling Zechariah. You know, they make up this name or something. You know, these entities are having a ball.
They probably are, too. It's probably one big entity party in somebody's body.
Yeah. Manly P. Hall says the clairvoyant has earned his right to see by opening his pineal gland. And he is a knower. He doesn't need to channel because he knows.
He's got the answers within.
Yeah, you said it.
Everybody wants a free ticket.
Oh, yeah. They want someone else to teach them. Oh, guru's coming to town. Let's pay $6,000 to go and have a meal with this idiot.
So true, though.
Yeah, well, they put themselves on pedestals, and usually stuff falls off of pedestals. And if you wait long enough and patient, you'll see the fall. These people will fall in their stupidity.
And if you want followers, that's just basically coming from a place of ego as well, really.
Oh, these guys, they're egotistical, man. I'm not going to name any names because I don't want to enter into any entanglement with any of these fools, but are they ego trippers or what?
Yeah.
Oh, and they've got no references, they've got no quotes, they make this stuff up and pluck it out of the air. I'm going to expose one of these charlatans very soon. His name's David Simonton. He's one of the biggest charlatans on the planet. He lives in New Queensland, and I had the unfortunate situation to be involved with him. He has a webinar service, and he talks about the dark agenda and everything like that. He thinks he's James Bond. He likes to tell people he is. He's got helicopters and all sorts of things. He's been in jail. He's a criminal. He's crashed my computer 3 times. What he did 6 months ago was he offered his webinar services so I could get my truth out there, because he claimed to be a supporter of it. At the time, I used the services once, and he offered to help me clean my computer and stole all of my email addresses. And I'm talking about all the people who have contacted me over music, because I'm a musician. And I'm pretty well known around the track.
Heard your music. You can play.
So he's stolen these email addresses from me and gone and taken it upon himself to offer his webinar services, and using my name and picture He's gone and emailed people. I've got contacts from Melbourne City Council because I perform in the heart of the city of Melbourne. So I know all the councillors and I know everybody. And they now come to me saying, how can we get rid of these webinar things that you're sending us? And I have to tell everybody around the world, please, please, I do not do mail-outs. Santos Bonacci has never emailed anybody about anything, to do with music. I think I've sent 3 newsletters in my 12-year career of professional music, and that's when I've released new albums. Now, I approached him and I said, please, David, don't do that again. He did it again. I did it 4 times. He's crashed my computer 3 times. The last time was last week. I left it on overnight, and he got in because he does his work at midnight to 6 in the morning when everybody else is sleeping. I have 5 witnesses that will come on radio, and I'll do a 2-hour radio show exposing this charlatan. Again, another media mystic. Just look at them. You can just see from a mile away that they're charlatans. Run away, people. Now, and remember the name David Simonson, because I'm going to see if jail is the best place for him to return to.
I was just going to say, is there any way you can bring him up on charges for all that?
Oh, I will. Yeah, he'll be charged. The guy who's cleaning up the computer, he knows what he's doing. And I've already got evidence that the day after he crashed my computer, I was on this very laptop that I'm talking to you with, and TeamViewer pops up, and there are his details on the bottom. I panicked. My heart just went boom, boom. I rushed for the modem off button and turned it off just in time, because he knows what to do.
Before the mouse starts cursoring around, stealing a lot of
things. Oh, yeah, man, I grabbed hold of the mouse, and I pulled it, and I just pulled it away from him. The next day, he did the very same thing, and I've got the details. I've got the details. Here is his ID, people, for anyone listening. On the bottom of TeamViewer, it said DSSI/GESG. That's his corporation. That's his business, GESG. And the number in parentheses is 70950959. So, look, I have so many supporters. The other night I had dinner with the band members of Seal. Seal is in Australia for the Logie Awards, and his band members are big, big fans of my astrotheology. I don't mention the people who I have that are following my work. And Paul Summerlin is one of the, and Marcus, I forget his surname, but Mark and Marcus and Paul's brother Mark, Marcus and Gus, all 4 members of Seal's band. I spent like 5 hours with them just talking about astrotheology. I have this kind of people all around me in the world, thousands, and I've only got this one enemy, David Simonton, that has caused so much havoc in my life that I can't begin to tell you guys how much this one man, and he keeps talking about the dark agenda. Anyway, I'm gonna address this guy very soon, and I apologize to all you people, all the people that are still receiving. You see, on the bottom of his newsletters, he has the click button to unsubscribe, but the trick is you can't unsubscribe. So I've got relatives, I've got people from my music past, directors of corporations and all sorts of people approaching me saying, hey, is this guy and can I use the word asshole?
You can say whatever you want, Santos.
Yeah, most of the people out there are so irate with this man that they say, is he an asshole or what? Because they write to him,
more names for him than that.
Yeah, they write to him saying, please, please unsubscribe us. Please, we beg of you. And he doesn't do it. This is the sort of sadistic pleasure that this idiot, this unconscious idiot, just like all the rest of the buffoon media mystic channelers out there, are doing. They're doing damage to themselves and damage to humanity. It's time to wake up, people. It's time to do the right things and learn the science and be a knower rather than a believer and a follower.
Absolutely. Follow your heart. Don't believe the hype.
Yeah.
That's all there is. Just look into yourself and see what resonates true for you.
Yep.
And if you want help with that, I have some friends in Anonymous who might be able to tell you how to handle that guy.
Oh, Kathy, let me tell you that Mr. David Simonton, the idiot of idiots, the unconscious lard ass that he is.
It sounds like you like this guy too much.
Look, I'm sending him this with love, by the way.
Of course.
But he is a fat head, he is a fat belly, and he is a fat ass, and I don't know what's filling the head. Is it the same stuff that's in the ass? That's what I'd like to know.
He's a coattail rider is what I like to call him.
Yeah.
It's a ride for coattails.
Google his name. He's a criminal. He's been to jail for 6 months. The Australian government jailed him. Why? Because he's a criminal. David Simpson is a criminal, lard-ass, buffoon medium.
You hear that, David Simpson?
That's David Simpson.
We're coming for you.
Yeah, and a whole heap of other enlightened of humanity. And how are we going to do it? With beautiful, loving consciousness.
Absolutely.
Let's blow these people away with our beautiful breath of love.
Because love is one of the only things that can disrupt the flow of fear, in my opinion. You know,
it does.
Much
and
more
it
powerful.
Does. And it's caused me a lot of sleepless nights. And but look, I didn't sleep much last night and the night before and the night before because it's going to cost me so much to fix this computer. It's going and who knows how many addresses and email, whatever that I've lost. Who knows what sort of files I've lost. And so, but I'm on this radio talking to you. I'm really, really tired, but I'm enjoying it. But David Simonton is there working for the dark agenda to stop people from hearing these beautiful truths. Because why would, I mean, I've only got one, my life's bliss. I go, there's a hill behind my house. I take my shoes off and go walking on the dirt, as Hirarutan Manik says, walk on the dirt for 45 minutes every day and you will have perfect health. I solar gaze. I drink my beautiful homegrown cannabis tea. I have a beautiful wife who loves me beyond. She's a Sagittarian angel, Japanese. And she, it seems that, to me, it appears that she just lives to serve me and make my life blissful. And she's so heavenly and patient.
It's unconditional. It's an unconditional love, and that's a beautiful thing.
I have a beautiful spoodle cavoodle dog called Mocha who comes walking with me every day and thinks that she's going to marry me when she grows up. She loves me that much. And she sits, she's right now, I can with my toe, I can rub her head because she's waiting for me. She's waiting for me to get off the radio and go out and throw the ball. My life is blissful apart from one person who is just trying to hack my life. One person. So I'd like to say that if anyone has recorded this, to make a copy of it and send it to David Simonton because he is doing damage to many other people. In the next few weeks, I will have interviews with two other people, one in England and one in Portugal, who beautiful souls, who he calls reptilians that work for the dark agenda, who he has destroyed also their computers in the same way, and we, the three of us, out of the mouth of three witnesses, shall the conviction come for David Simonton to go back to jail because he's going to be charged, he's going to be absolutely processed, and all of his team that works with him because he's working with a bunch of creepy, creepy people. And long live the king consciousness, as Plotinus, the great Neoplatonist, said. Long live consciousness, and down with unconsciousness and ignorance and superstition and fear. Now is the time to embrace the light.
As you say, philosophy is science, pure and simple. Atoms are God, and that's what we are.
Well, that's all it is.
That's all it is. Hey, why don't you mention your book, Santos? We'd like to...
I don't have a book because... And if I wrote a book, Kathy, let me tell you... Rand, I keep not... Rand's so quiet that I'm just not very... I'm sorry, I should...
Rand wanted to get into all the court legal system stuff. So we have to have you back on again to talk about how the court system works. That's what Rand wanted to talk about today.
Well, I'll stay back another hour if you like.
Yeah, really?
Oh, for sure.
That would be awesome.
I'm at everyone's service.
Thank you so much for agreeing to stick around. That's really gracious of you.
Yeah, thank you.
We appreciate that.
No problem. I'll do 10 hours a day if you want. The stuff that I have to share is urgent. It's urgent right now. It's absolutely urgent. I've been very, very blessed to have the right books and the right information fall into my laps. 500 years ago, a certain gentleman called Giovanni Pico della Mirandola, when he met speaking to his master, Marsilio Ficino. These were Renaissance hermetists. And he said, "Divine providence has caused certain books to fall into my hands." And I feel the same way. If I did not receive the information that I did because I was searching, I've always been searching, and if I didn't persist, I wouldn't have this information. And I know that it is absolutely urgent. So if you want to have me on any time, I'm at your service.
Thank you. I'm a big believer that nothing in life is a mistake, and you are sent here to deliver this information, Santos. I totally believe that. And then you do it with such great enthusiasm and love and just passion. It's a pleasure to see, and it's a pleasure to see someone who's so giving with their time as you are. So thank you for that.
Yep, thank you.
You're very welcome. Where do we begin? Do we begin in 1302, or do we just get right to the meat and potatoes? That's what I'm wondering.
Ooh.
They go right to the heart of it, like the Vatican owns all our souls.
Yes.
Or they think they own our souls.
Yeah. Well, let's go to 1302 then, shall we?
Okay.
So we had a pope kicking around at the time called, and take note of the names of these popes, the idiots. This idiot was called Boniface, do-gooder. Bon means good, and face means to do. Anyway, he writes up this little bit of a scribble on what he calls a papal bull, written in blood, on the skin of a kid. Now, please check out the work of Franco Collins, another researcher here in Australia. He's found, and he's not the only one. The kid is a real kid, a human kid. These guys don't do things in short. They don't do things in, small measures. They go the full hog. These guys are real, real demons. And Pope Boniface in 1302 wrote up the papal bull called Unam Sanctum, in which he says, we sit on top of the world virtually, and everything that's in it, it belongs to us, the Catholic Church. Basically, that's what he said. Titles, land, everything, the lot. All souls must be baptized as Catholic to be saved, or they shall perish. And so what they did is they set about creating some trusts. Eventually, the first one was in 1455, and then another one was in 1481, just 2 years before Columbus set sail, and then the Jesuits gave us the final trust called Convocation in 1537. But these thugs, run by the Venetians, otherwise known as the Phoenicians, and David Icke's work's pretty good when it comes up to this, let me tell you, he's uncovered the Phoenician commerce, merchant aspect to all of this domination. You see, the system in place is Phoenician, which gives us the word phony, the phony Phoenicians. And they became the merchants of Venice, you see, Venice, the Venetians. And they married into, the Dutch royal family, Germanic bloodlines, the Windsor family is Guelph from Venice. They're Venetian, scum of the earth. Back then, they founded the Jesuits, to counter the Reformation, which was another scam anyway. They're all scams, all of them. Persecutors of Hermetus is what they are. And in 1302, Unum Sanctum basically channeled all of the property into this express trust that they made. Now, don't think that this is when it all began. You've got to go back to Julius Caesar's crowd. That's when the real crime began. And Constantine's family. Also, the Flavians that ruled from 69 to the late 1st century, Vespasian, Domitian, and Titus. These guys were criminals beyond your imagination, Guy. Sure, they gave us the Colosseum, the Flavian amphitheatre for bread and circuses, and people think that that's good. That's civilization, great architecture, great games. Of course, sports are so nice, they keep us distracted. So, tourists go to the Colosseum thinking that it's this great, well, it is. It is a great architecture, but what it stands for, what the Flavians did it for, was to give us a symbol of bread and circuses. And today, they still give us the arenas and the stadiums where we can go and see baseball and football and soccer and how many codes. I mean, they're making new codes. They gave us the concept of bread and circus to keep people distracted whilst the black nobility Roman families are stealing all their wealth through taxes called donations with all of their filthy, dirty, gummy so-called Christian churches, because Christianity is the science of light. Christ means light. And it was founded in Egypt eons and eons ago, according to Augustine and Eusebius and Ptolemy and Josephus. When you read, you find these things. Of course, when you talk, you know, over a dinner table with consensus buffoons, they'll laugh at you and they'll say, ha, 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 you're funny, Santos. You're a dreamer. Of course, because they don't read anything. Their own people tell them. Their very own teachers and doctors are telling them.
So you they're, in essence, sheep themselves.
Yeah. Eusebius teaches us that the Gospels were created by the Essenes and the Therapeutae and the Telestoi, the people from Serapis, the Christians, hundreds of years before the so-called invented Christ, the third-party debt collector of all time. The IRS, rest assured, they love Jesus and the Federal Reserve. They love Jesus. Eusebius tells you that there never was a time when Christianity did not exist, because it's the science and teaching of light. And that's only one quote. I can give you hundreds. It's hundreds. It's literally, but I don't bother. I really don't bother anymore. Unless people are really listening, like yourselves and the listeners of this radio show, and will pick these things up and run with them, I don't give a hoot. Because the people who hear but don't listen and laugh at all of this stuff and run away, they're not worth it. It's throwing pearl to the swine anyway, so I don't give a hoot. I'm happy. But what they did was they created a system whereby we would be enslaved, and it's the Inquisition, and the Inquisition is running our courts. The priests of Baal, the Bar, who are foreign agents, those men in black, and black being for Saturn, being for Latin, because they harvest that particular destructive negative energy of Saturn. When you understand what Saturn means in all of its aspects, then you understand all things.
Is that because they do things on specific days, like in the winter months, where they'll be more apt to cause harm?
Yep, absolutely. When Saturnian influence is at its best. I'll give you a real quick example, and then I'll get off it really quickly. The Twin Towers were built in 1971 and opened in 1973 while Saturn was in Gemini, the twins. Okay. And then it was destroyed 30 years later when Saturn returned in his 29-and-a-half-year cycle on 2001, September 11, right on cue. And Saturn, when the first plane hit, Saturn was in the ninth house, called the House of Travel. And when the second plane hit 17 minutes after, Saturn was already to be found in the eighth house, which is the House of Death.
That's very
check
interesting.
It out.
Rand is a big guru on the 9/11 truth. So that's information.
Yeah, I didn't know about that.
He's very
amazing.
Happy to get.
Wow.
Yeah, and guess who was on the ascendant right at the hour in the signs of Libra? Mercury, the messenger. He was rising right 0 degrees, 0 degrees on the ascendant. And the sun was in Virgo, a mutable sign. If you know what mutable means, it means destruction and transformation and mutability and unease and separation and duality and all of that stuff. Shiva, the destroyer. So the sun was in Virgo, squaring with Saturn in Gemini, another mutable sign, and Pluto was still in Capricorn back then, in Sagittarius back then. So there's nearly a grand cross in the sky, in a mutable grand cross in the sky, minus one component. But there's a pretty good square there. The sun squaring with Saturn and Pluto. Saturn is chief killer, destroyer, death symbol, and Pluto is a destroyer and transformer. These people absolutely follow Saturn. That's why the Jews wear their yarmulke. That's the rings of Saturn. That's why they wear black, because the color black is Saturn.
Earrings, because you say we hear with our ears, but we can also see with our ears, correct?
Yes, Saturn rules the ear. That's why you put the ear rings on the ear. The sun rules the eyes, of course. No one else rules the eyes, because how can you see without the sun?
Right.
Plato says the eyes need a third thing, whereas the ears hear directly. The third thing is the teacher, the sun. the cause, the light. You see, the sun is the light of the world. Without the sun, we don't see. Anyway, getting back, they use Saturn, they use it all, they use all these dates, and I've given an abundance of dates in my videos. You just have to go through them. There's 12 of them, and there's two more coming in the next few weeks, by the way. Two very, very good presentations about some very important information. The galactic alignment and the science of light are the two subjects of my next presentations, which will be up soon. And please catch them, because you will learn so many things about this. And I'm going to do a presentation on the physiology, which I discussed in the first hour, very, very soon, because it's urgent. Now, the system that they've created, this inquisition in the courts, you see, when you go to court, they summons you for a hearing. The hearing is, "Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. It's a hearing. It's the inquisition. The judge or the magistrate is an ordinary. An ordinary is an officer of the church to pass the church's sentences and laws on all the idiots who go to church. The bench, the bank, the judge sits on the bench, which is the bank. Same thing as the church. And the prosecutor, the one that stands in your skin, accusing you, the prosecutor is the accuser.
Mm-hmm.
So the judge says, "Will the accused please stand and come forward?" This is the same justice system that accused Giordano Bruno in the year 1600 and killed him and murdered him. He was accused by who? Prosecutors. And then you bring an attorney or a liar or a lawyer with you. What's an attorney? Well, he turns you over.
Yeah.
They are all traitors. They are treacherous, evil venom, or at least their system is. But let me rest you assured that there is a good percentage of these Saturnian devils called magistrates, wolves in sheep's coverings, that are absolutely putrid and evil. And they are judging our little boys that go to court for speeding fines and possession of cannabis, and these monsters are throwing them into prison. These absolute criminals that know that those poor boys did nothing wrong. Nothing.
It's not a little thing when you ruin someone's life and, you know, hurt the way they can get a job or go to school even for the rest of their life. It's not cool.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to shut them down. That sounds arrogant, but what else have I got to live for? Kathy, what else am I? You know, some people say, "Oh, Santos, this spiritual stuff you're doing, it's distracting you from your musical career." Two hoots with my music, man. Two hoots about anything. I'm going to sit back patiently, not sit back. I'm not resting on my laurels. I'm going to see the day when these people like the Pope and the Queen and all these idiots are processed properly. And they will. And our eyes will see it. Mene, mene, tekel, parson. Was what Belshazzar saw in the last days of Babylon. He saw the handwriting on the wall, and it said, "Mene, mene, tekel, parson. Your kingdom has been weighed in the scales, found wanting, and you will be judged." Why do you think these chief CEOs of banks are resigning in their droves and committing suicide? Because guess what? Mene, mene, tekel, parson. Hallelujah. The time has come. The time has come when all these charlatans, like David Symington and all these idiots, are put back in jail where they belong. Like the Pope. The Pope deserves to be in jail. He runs, he's the king of pedophiles, and he runs a big pedophile clan. It's a death cult, the Catholic Church, which goes around killing people. They own Baxter and Bayern and Johnson & Johnson, all these big pharma. Because why? Well, because they want to treat people rather than cure them of their diseases. Uh-huh. They've got cancer treatments, they've got all sorts of treatments. They're not interested in herbal cures. You know, Paracelsus gave us homeopathy and herbal cures. And there are people out there like Dr. Sebi curing people of all kinds of diseases with herbs. And the Catholic death cult owns all of Big Pharma. Rest assured, please, please don't be so ignorant, listeners, to think that they don't own everything that's out there. The corporation is the Church of Saint Peter, and the Jehovah's Witnesses are just under them. The Mormons are under that umbrella. the Seventh-day Adventist, all these idiots, they're all under the historical Christ corporation, which is the Inquisition. It's the Antichrist. The true Christ is within.
I think they're also involved in black ops projects, too. The kind of gene pool where they take children and make them super soldiers and ruin their lives. You know, it probably has a lot to do with that as well. Those people being fed through, you know, these boys town and kids disappearing and things like that. It's just so hurtful. It just breaks my heart. I can't deal with it. It's got to change. I can deal with it, and it pisses me off really bad. And it's a big reason why I'm here today, because I just cannot stand injustice of any kind. It really annoys me, especially when you hurt a child.
Yeah, I think you touched on the Franklin cover-up with Larry something, King or something.
Larry King?
Anyway, yeah. Remember the Franklin cover-up?
Is that the Boys Town?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have seen that. It's very sad.
That's...
Anybody who thinks Boys Town is a nice place with rainbows, it's not.
No, I can tell you who that is. That is none other than the Catholic Church. The Vatican is absolutely our connection to the animal chakra of the earth. The earth is a being. She has seven chakras as we do. Everything does. Everything is permeated with seven. There is a septenary, serpentary octave of physical manifestation all throughout this universe. So the earth must be a sevenfold orb. One of her chakras is the dark satellite. Her number one child, as Helena Blavatsky taught us, is the darkest sorcerers that ever were on this universe that sit on that little hill at the Vatican. And once it is destroyed and obliterated, we will have peace on this earth. The Rothschilds pay homage to it. Queen Elizabeth does, George Bush, the Bohemian Grovers, Skull and Boners, all of these imbeciles, they all bow down and worship the image of the beast. Because they're all idiots, they're all unconscious buffoons. Nonetheless, they are our brothers, and we do extend our love to them. But I guarantee you, be patient, keep your eyes open, because in the next few years, you will see many of these perishing before your eyes. There will be a great destruction of humanity because they don't want to wake up. They are unconscious, and they love it. They love it.
Santos, quick question. You mentioned earlier about the CEOs resigning, probably like rats deserting a sinking ship. And we're hearing about liens put on all the Federal Reserve banks and things to that effect. Do you really feel that the people, the elite that are running the financial institutions of the world are actually on the run and things are going to change and possibly an asset-based Iraqi dinar-type currency will be revalued, and then there's also the Nasara movement. Do you know anything about that and how that might relate to what's coming?
Yeah, all these movements, I see them as good on one level, all of them. I don't see them as all bad or all good as other people do. You know, they see the Occupy movement as all bad or all good. They don't see it as both, and they are. They're all both. You know, what's happening in Syria, Egypt, Greece, Portugal, whatever, Spain, what's happening there is all good and bad. It's all the same thing. People are on different consciousness levels. What will come after the fiction is busted and destroyed, which is the usury system of the Swiss bankers, of the Knights Templar in Switzerland, once that is totally, it was a Ponzi scheme from the start, once it has busted, which it will, in the next few weeks, it's only weeks away, we will just default back to the original currency, which is loving exchange of goods and energy from one brother to another. You see, I love you, Rand and Kathy, and I love my wife, and I love everybody. So I'm going to give them a bit of bread if I've got a bit of bread. I've got some whatever growing out the back in the garden.
Absolutely.
If you want some of my cannabis, I've got some beautiful cannabis.
Oh, I do.
Yeah, that's good to know.
I'll share it with you. I'll smoke it with you. I'll drink it with you.
Now we're talking.
I will share my love That is currency. Those filthy, dirty pieces of paper that we kill our mothers for, that is nothing. That's a thing of the past. That's over. And despite all these beautiful people who are out there protesting and organizing and doing things and putting liens on the Federal Reserve, this is all great. It's good and it's bad and it's good. It doesn't matter. The ultimate thing is we have come here. We have come here to see the fruition of our hard labor of many, 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 many incarnations and suffering. And consciousness finally is coming home. We've got to crucify the Christ in the pineal gland. Bring the oil up. Raise the Christ. Raise the soul. Know who you are. Know that you are God, for ye are God.
Know thyself.
Yes, and you will know the universe and all of its gods, because there are none out there that are not in there. In fact, the Egyptians, and for all of these churchgoer clowns who say that the Egyptians worship demons and animal-headed this and animal-headed that, in fact, they called those glyphs, they called them netters. And netter, N-E-T-R, is the word that we get nature from. Yeah, they did. Absolutely, they did respect nature. They were not demons. It was nature. They are aspects of nature. For Jupiter is an aspect of nature. Mars is an aspect of nature. That's all it is. Aspects of light. Just as truth is a resonance, a vibration of light. Love is light. Sound is light. Matter is light. Electricity is light. God is light. We are light. It's all light. So why do people choose the darkness and to stay down in the lower chakras and keep feeding on that seed and killing it the moment it's born rather than saving it and transmuting it? Because they don't know. They don't know.
Old habits, old habits die hard.
Yeah. And so if we know these things, we know who we are. When you go to court, you know who you're talking to. You know who all the actors are. You know, the judge turns around and says, and you're acting as who today?
And do you understand?
Yeah, exactly. And one actor says, I'm acting as a defense attorney today, Your Honor. And the other one says, I'm acting as prosecutor today, Your Honor. So they're all acting. So if you go in and you know who you are, you know that you are nameless. When the judge says, and who are you? Well, you can say, well, I am. And are they going to throw you in jail for that? They can never contract with the I am. That's why they want you to have a name. You see, look at the word name. In Latin, nomen, N-O-M-E-N. Do I need to say any more?
They need to contract with that straw man, so that's why they need you to give your name, right?
Yeah, you're no man.
Yeah.
They want you to negate that you are a man, because that's what you are. Whether you're a woman or a man, you are a man. But if you have a no man or a name, look at it in Spanish. Do you know much Spanish? A man in Spanish is hombre. A name is nombre. So you just put N in front of the word for man. So in other words, N is a negation. All the negation words begin with N. No, non, never, nowhere, nobody, nothing, nope. And so when he says your name, please, he's just dying for you to contract with him, because if he hears that you know who you are and you say, I am, well, then he's like, oh, all right, well, you have no business here, do you? Because we're just doing commerce. I'm just sitting on this bench. I'm just an ordinary for the Inquisition hearing a case is being processed against a corporate name, Santo Bonacci. Are you Santo Bonacci? Your Honor, I just said I am. What does Santo Bonacci mean? Last time I checked, there's a million people on the planet called Santo. And I've got a million relatives that have the Bonacci surname. So I'm not original, but what's original is what's in my heart and my blood. I can tell you who I am. Is that what you want to know, Your Honor? Do you want to know who I am? Do you care for me so much that you want to know who I am? I'll tell you my story. But if you want me to create joinder with that name, well, that's another thing, because I know who I am. I know I am the Christ. The oil is within. I have a claustrum. I have a cerebellum. I have a cerebrum. I have an optic thalamus. I'm the complete package. I don't need your services, Mr. Judgy Boy, Mr. Judgy Poo, you wolf in sheep coverings. And he's already a traitor. He doesn't have an oath. By the way, if you want to go to court, ask them to produce their oath. Tell me, Judgy Boy, Do you have an oath that you will love me and you will love yourself and your God that you profess to worship and that you will serve humanity in truth and you will hear this case with a just heart? Give me that oath, buddy. Because if you're not prepared to do that, you can go to hell. Because hell is where they come from. And that's where they will return. Very swiftly. They better resign now, man, while there's a chance to get on the right side. Because if you're resonating with Babylon the Great, you will go down with her and share with her in all her sins. No one will escape this. No one's going to escape the vibration that's coming. It's not about judgment. It's not about, oh, Jesus is coming in the clouds. He's going to save us believers in the Southern Baptist Northern Lakes 1928, what do they call them, franchises now. What are they? They're sects, denominations, like the Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, they're corporate registered entities. They're only going to save this denomination of the Baptist, but he's coming in the clouds, and all the Jehovah's Witnesses are going to die, and all those unbelievers and Buddhists and all the other labels. You see what sort of clowns we're dealing with? We're dealing with, basically, sad to say, that most of the humans on the planet are really just animals. And in Hermetic science, they are human animals, human beasts. They're clever. They can press the green button in their 9 to 5, 40 hours a week jobs, and the red button. They know the red button stop, and they know the green ones, and they know who's winning the football. They're pretty intelligent, but they're unconscious. You see, there's conscious human beings, and there's unconscious human beasts. And unfortunately, we've lived through an onslaught of incarnation of these lower forms. And they're running America. Barack Obama's one of them. You can't tell me he's conscious. He's got a little resort called Guantanamo Bay down there somewhere where they're actually persecuting and destroying and torturing human beings with sound and gases and harp and all sorts of things. So that would indicate that he's an unconscious animal in my books.
No doubt. The only thing these people are missing are their three-tiered crowns, you know? Why don't you tell everyone about the symbology between the three-tiered crown, because it kind of ties into the property, real estate, soul bit.
Well, yes, the tiara or the trirenium, which the last three popes have declined to wear. I wonder why. Boniface, he had his two-tier Dagon's hat, the mitre of the fish god Dacon, because we're living in the age of Pisces. Of course they're going to have a mitre, a trirenium. But the three kingdoms that they rule over, that's the three souls of the three trusts that your birth certificate name is registered under, the Sestwi KV trusts called, that come from Unum Sanctum 1302, And by the way, they killed the Jacques. Jacques was in prison at the time when Boniface enacted this crime. And 5 years later, with King of France, Philip, they killed Jacques de Molay. They tortured him and destroyed the original Knights Templar. But you can rest assured that these three trusts called Convocation, Attorney Regis, and Pontifex Maximus, interesting names, do some research. Just Wikipedia will tell you enough information that will blow your mind, that will put you straight. As for these consensus buffoons,
watching your videos blew my mind already. I'm still mulling it all around in my head. It's so much, so many things get connected, and it's like, wow. You know, it's like getting five PhDs at once, honestly. So much information.
Because, Kathy, it's syncretic. What's the use of isolating a conspiracy subject there's a lot of use in it, but what's the use of seeing it as an isolated, separate part of the whole matrix? What's the use of having a mind that can't see that all things are interrelated? Why can't we see that Plato said the same thing as Pythagoras, said the same thing as Hermes, said the same thing as Moses, etc.? I mean, why do they want the divisions? I don't know. I mean, I do, divide and conquer. But I don't know why people are falling for it. They're falling for it. You know, McDonald's sets up businesses and says, we're going to give you hamburgers. And what they're giving you is everything other than food. They're giving you shit. They're putting a lot of flavor on that shit, but it's shit nonetheless. And people are lining up to eat that stuff. Now, just do a bit of homework. Google it. What's in McDonald's food? And you will see that it's not stuff that you should be ingesting. It's stuff that you should be... Yeah. It's stuff that you should be, let's say, putting it on your enemy's doorstep as a gift, in kindness for him to eat. Because it's going to kill him.
I think we should round up all the CEOs, put them in a FEMA camp, and just only feed them McDonald's.
Yeah, and Kentucky Fried Chicken and Burger
King. Yeah, there you go.
They're dead in a week.
That's why I hate when people say, though, too, oh, the FEMA camp conspiracy theory. What's all that about? The evil minions need slaves to do their bidding for them. I'm like, tell that to everybody who was in the Holocaust. You know, hungry, starving people cannot fight back for themselves. It crushes their soul. It crushes their hope and their existence. This is what they hope that happens to us, really. To have no skills to deal and no desire to fight back because our souls are so stamped on by them. Weapons they use and food they use and jails they use. Just makes me crazy.
Yeah. Good luck. Good luck to all those people that are going to raise that Christ oil up to the pineal gland with all the fluoridated water that they've drunk. There are enough independent scientists out there that have written papers on the destruction of the pineal gland due to fluoride. Of course, consensus scientists tell you that it's good for your teeth and for your pineal gland and for everything else. My dentist, who's just a buffoon, he's a good dentist. He's got a good heart and everything like that, but he's a champion for fluoride, and he laughs at me. Oh, Santos, you got to stop listening to those alternative people. Fluoride, I wish there was fluoride in the water when I was a child. I'd have better teeth than I have today, Santos. And I say to him, listen, mate, of course your scientists are going to tell you that because they want you to sell fluoride, and they're making a lot of money out of this poison. But have you checked out on the internet the independent scientists? I'm not speaking from ignorance here. I'm quoting other scientists that have proven that fluoride is harmful. Mr. Dentist Boy. And, of course, they're in denial because they know that they've been pumping little children with fluoride, and they know the harm. Dentists know the harm that they are causing to children. And, of course,
with
they're going to be in denial.
Well. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, but it's going to catch up to them. I'll tell you what, they're going to be sorry little boys. And my dentist, he's got a Mercedes-Benz, and he thinks it's always parked at the front there. They've all got their Mercedes-Benzes and their BMW and all their wanker cars, and they think they're shit-hot with their dentist, because they're dentists. They're killing people.
I wrote from my daughter's dentist file, absolutely no fluoride or mercury products of any kind. I wrote it in big letters, and the nurse looked at me like I was crazy. You know, like she didn't have a clue, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, they look at you like,
trying to sell it to me. I'm saying, baby, you're going to have to learn better sales skills than that because I'm not buying it, you know?
Yeah, Channel 7 says fluoride's good. What are you talking about, woman? And Channel 9 does too. I checked that channel.
The dentist went to college. He should know what's good for your child. I'm like, well, you know, he didn't give birth to her. So he doesn't love her like I do. I'm not buying a fluoride deal.
I had
known back when she was little about the shots. I had no idea. I feel total guilt over getting her so many shots when she was a baby. It just breaks my heart. You know?
Yeah, and they are crying at the moment that they get these shots.
I know, and they're looking at you like, why are you letting this man hurt me? The look in her eyes like, why are you letting this man hurt me? And it just like broke my heart. She was trying to tell me right then and there that it wasn't right, and I should have listened to her, really.
Yeah, and here's me, a regular going Jehovah's Witness little boy, and my son was born 19 years ago, but I would not vaccinate him. And they kept telling me, oh, you're not going to get him through school. I got him through school. I wish I didn't. He left at 15 just like his daddy because he was sick of the bullshit. He said, Dad, I'm out of here, man. This is psycho-tripping mind control at its worst. My son, I'm proud of him. My son, I'm so proud of my son. He is so switched on. He sent his Denike ultimatum form into the local Dandenong courts because they were going to charge him for driving without suspended license. And he sent that in. He didn't have to go to court. He wasn't immunized. He's a rapper. His lyrics are just like Tupac. They are against the system. He's got the best lyrics that you've ever heard any rapper, my son. I'm so proud of him. He grows his own hemp. He's got a beautiful little girlfriend. He is into psychedelics and entheogens. He understands that one must take these responsibly. And he has read the Hermetica. And he has transformed his life, my son. I'm so proud of my 19-year-old son. Unaffected by fluoride. I bought him a beautiful fluoride water filter, even one for his shower. We have shower heads that take out the fluoride. And I love having a shower. I have long showers. And, of course, I don't believe the myth that we're running out of water, so I don't have these short, cold showers like these idiots do to save water. There's plenty of H2O out there. I can enjoy breathing the water because there's no fluoride. In the other shower in the house, I turn it on for a minute, the bathtub, and it stinks. It's putrid. It stinks like a chemical cocktail. But in my shower, in my ensuite, hallelujah.
Wow.
Nice.
It's raining water.
I would love to get one of those fluoride filters for the shower. That sounds awesome.
I've had one.
You can get one for $40 on the internet. I'll
really?
link you the website. It's in America. You'll get it there, $5 postage.
Very cool. Oh, I totally would like you to do that too. That'd be awesome.
Yeah, but I'd be following the work of Andrew Norton Weber and drinking distilled water. I've got a few archives. Distilled water and drinking your own urine. This is the best liquid that you can pump through your system. Check it out.
Someone had asked in the chat room earlier if you were a breatharian or a vegan, because I know that you've talked about how some types of true enlightened beings, you know, don't eat their brother, which is like, you know, the cow or...
Yeah, I am, let's say, I'm pretty vegan. I would say I'm 99% vegan. I might have some ricotta. I think that's... But look, I don't see cheeses and eggs. These, unless those animals are cooped up and tortured and little coops. But I don't see raw milk and cheese as something that comes... It hasn't got blood in it. It hasn't been...
Right.
It's not something that had to give its life. I mean,
right.
why would you eat a hamburger? That cow was happy living. Yeah. All animals love their lives. They want to live them as long as they can. I mean, hello. We don't have to take it off them.
There's a reason why Jewish people eat kosher, too, because of the way they kill the animal and because of the way they bless things when they you know, make their food products. That, you know, if it's kosher, it comes from more of a place of love, so your body will receive it better.
Yeah. But as for breatharian, one can achieve breatharianship, if you want to call it that, by careful and responsible, safe solar gazing, walking on dirt barefoot every day, 45 minutes, solar gazing, eating natural herbs that come from this planet. Don't touch peppermint, chamomile, aloe vera, comfrey. These are hybrids, corn, wheat.
Really?
These are hybrids. They are acidic. They are below 7 on the pH scale. They will kill you. Acid is cancer. Acid is death. Alkaline is electric. Eat things. See, urine and distilled water is alkaline. Yes, they try to discourage people from drinking distilled water because they say it's acidic. Oh, yeah, it's 6.7 on the scale, which means it is acidic. But in the body, just like lemon juice, it is alkaline, so they give you half truth to steer.
Like a fish tank. The body's like a fish tank, basically.
Yeah, they give you a bum steer so people say, oh, right, okay, there you go, I don't have to take distilled water, it's been debunked. And when you alkalize your body, you electrify it. It's electricity. You'll never get a disease. You'll never get anything. I've never had a thing to my name. I don't know what arthritis and all that stuff is. I had a headache when I was 9. I can remember that. That was awful. That's it. Because I'm 49 and I'm healthy. I can run with my dog, do somersaults and everything. There's not a There's not a thing wrong with me, except probably the amalgam teeth fillings that I've got. I've got a hunch that I need to get rid of those because I'm feeling a lot of soreness in my teeth and everything, and there is a problem with my teeth, and I think I'm losing weight from the toxins that come from that. That's the only thing that I can think of. Apart from that, my head works okay, my blood, my circulation. I'm a happy person, and we can all be happy. Know who you are. Know what to put into your precious temple. The body is the temple of God. God is light. It's a temple of light. It's full of all of the angles and organs. Look at it this way. You have 7 vital organs in your body, and they are all ruled by the vital orbs in the solar system. The sun rules the heart. Of course it does. That's a vital organ. The brain is ruled by, the silver stuff is ruled by the moon. That's a vital organ. Saturn rules the spleen. The spleen is responsible for the etheric body and keeping the body vitalized. That's ruled by Saturn. Venus rules the kidneys. Jupiter rules the liver. Mars, the gallbladder. And Mercury, the lungs. Look around, know who you are, know what that means. Because if you don't, you're going to put a McDonald's soft serve down your gob, down your throat, because you think it tastes great and you're hungry. And that is the worst thing you can do. There are apples out there. There are things that you can eat that Mother Nature has made. She loves you, not the corporate companies that give you Mars bars and Snickers bars so that you can rest, work, and play. They want to poison you. And I mean that sincerely and truthfully. They deliberately do want to poison us because acidic food, acid, destroys the fluid in the spinal cord. It burns it. It burns it up. And alcohol does too. There are 3 things that destroy it. Overeating causes acidity in the body. It messes up the balance. And hence, the Christ oil also suffers. Not only, look around and see these obese people. They've got 6 or 7 flabs on their bellies and that go right past and almost, and they go way past and cover their genitalia. I can't understand how these people can actually go to the toilet and urinate because they've got these bellies that go down to their knees, some of them. I see hundreds of these in the mall when I go street performing, and I think to myself, my God, how much aspartame and diet-free shit have they put in their bodies, and they don't realize that it's that that's causing all of those.
Just the opposite of what you think.
Yeah, they give you the opposite. So believe me when I say that they deliberately are poisoning people. Because if they can destroy that oil, when your lamp runs out of oil, remember the 7 virgins that waited, the wise virgins and the 7 foolish virgins? The 7 foolish virgins in the gospel, they were waiting for the bridegroom. And the 7 foolish virgins went off because they ran out of oil in their receptacles and their lamps were going out. But the 7 wise ones were waiting. Well, the oil is the Christ Santa Claus fluid that is born in the solar plexus, Bethlehem, because the pineal gland and the pituitary gland are Joseph and Mary, the progenitors of the seed. And we're overeating, drinking lots of alcohol, and having sex at the wrong time, and spilling the seed, and guess what? It's deliberate.
Yes.
It's deliberate.
No, they Santa, don't... Is there a website where people can go to find out what the best time is to save their seed or to sow it, per se?
Every month when the moon is in the sign where your sun was when you were born. In my case, Aries. The moon will be in Aries in 4 days' time. That is the time that I need to abstain from sex like it's the devil. You see, it's all about science. And it's not that sex is the bad boy. Even though the book that I've recommended, The God-Man Word Flesh, appears to make it look like it. In some cases, it's not. I would complement the reading of this book with The Light of Egypt by Thomas H. Burgoyne, and in there he has a chapter on sex. You can go to Google and you can read it free. The Light of Egypt, Thomas H. Burgoyne, and he explains how you can use the transmutative energies of this Christ fluid that runs from your genitalia all the way back up to the optic thalamus, and bathe the soul in resonant light. People, it's time to turn to the light and become christened and enlightened. It's time to be saved within. Because not only does this save the soul and the spirit, it actually regenerates the physical organism. Some monks have been known to live for hundreds of years guarding this precious secret of the Christ within. Some people have, by just sustaining themselves on their urine and clean water and the breath and saving the seed, have lived for many, many, many hundreds of years.
That's amazing. And
yeah, it is the salvation. That's why the word salvation comes from salt. It is the salt of the earth. It's in your solar plexus every month when the moon is in your sun sign. Know astrology. Know where the moon is. Please, please know these things. Because there ain't many people out there teaching it. There's me, and I'm looking around for some others. So
You're not just speaking about sex with other people. You're talking about abstaining from orgasm altogether, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, I would never. I personally detest having an orgasm. It's such a disappointment. To be rewarded with this fleeting, exquisite moment, but exquisite nonetheless, but to be rewarded, to reward yourself after 10 or 20 minutes or 30 minutes of lovemaking is absolutely disappointing. It's your brain. It comes from the cerebrum. Cerebrum means cherubim, the covering angels, because the two spheres of the cerebrum cover over the cerebellum, which is the heart. That's the true heart, as a man thinketh. And when that orgasm, that seed, that's the brain. It's the brain fluid. It's the same stuff. But when it returns, it's of a higher energy. And as George Carly explains, it activates the dormant brain cells. And one becomes a Christ and has a halo and knows all things. You have opened the door. You have been crucified. You've crossed over. Beneath the optic thalamus is the pons. Pon, as in Pontifex Maximus, pons comes from bridge. You've got to cross the bridge, guys. If you don't cross the bridge, find the bridge. Where's that confounded bridge?
I was going to say, any religion that's against Led Zeppelin is not for me.
Exactly. Where's that confounded bridge?
Exactly.
It's in the head. It's the stairway to heaven, guys. Led Zeppelin, we're all about alchemy. Alchemy is the body. The body is a marvel in alchemy. Buy that gold, people. Buy that gold.
Because you don't want the levee to break.
That's right.
It's very, very true. We have about 3 minutes left. Is there anything you want to say and wrap up, Santos or Rand? Do you want to ask or anything? Or
no, the question I have would be a whole other hour. So,
well, we need to get Santos to come back on again.
Please.
Yes, definitely. We'd loved having you here. You're a pleasure to have alive, and your vast cornucopia of information and knowledge is the way your brain thinks is just amazing, and I think people should watch your videos because you can really get a lot of information and break it down a lot easier if you watch and take notes, because that's what I had to do. If I didn't take notes, yeah. I would have been lost in 10 minutes.
Yeah, I have several pages.
I bet you
He's really good at connecting the dots.
Yes, excellent.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you, Santos.
Yep.
Excellent.
And guys, thanks for being conscious, not intellectual or sophisticated or opinionated. Thanks for being conscious. You guys are really, really conscious. And that's consciousness is king, said Plotinus many, many years ago.
We try not to put our beliefs on other people. We just like to share the information and let them come to their own conclusion.
Yeah, this is stuff just to know. It's not stuff to believe in. Don't believe me. Just hear the words and know it. Just observe them. Just go around observing and knowing.
There's too many people in the truther, quote-unquote, arena bashing each other and not playing on the same team, and that's just stop too, in my opinion. Everybody's got a piece of the truth. Everybody's got a piece of the puzzle. We are the 99%. Another world is possible, and we are unstoppable. We just have to believe and do the work. Just absorb it and discern for yourself. The beginning song was by Portetius, and that was called With Christ. I mentioned the second song. And the last song we're going to play everybody out with is called Red Sun, and that's by Villains Like You. We'll see you on the flip side.
Something happening here.
Hi, everyone.
everyone. Tamara here. Just a reminder that you can connect with us on Facebook as well as subscribing to us on our YouTube channel. We'd love you to join us during live shows at blogtalkradio.com/truthconnection. And for information on upcoming shows, visit our website at truthconnections.wordpress.com. Thank you for your support, and never forget that the truth is reality and the connection is you.
Original sin.